Welcome to a time of reflection. I'm your host, Reverend Peter Burnett, to get to spend the next few minutes with you to just worship the Lord, to pray together. And I'm going to be sharing a word with you today concerning being a child of God, being childlike and being children before our Father. So once again, I want to welcome you, especially those of you on Facebook. I want to welcome you and remind you to share this link, just a copy and paste it in your WhatsApp group or in another Facebook page or YouTube. Those of you on YouTube, do the same thing. Subscribe. Let your friends and family know that the time of reflection is on. We come on each day at noon, 12 p.m., and also at 1 o'clock on Wednesdays, Monday through Friday. The time of reflection is here to stand with you, to encourage you. So whether you're on Facebook or YouTube, those of you on the channel 253 on Cornwall Communication Channel, I want to welcome you as well. Remember, call your friends, get them connected. 24/7 Faith Broadcasting Network is here to serve the body of Christ and to build you up. But welcome to the time of reflection. We're going to enter into a time of praise and worship, lifting up praise to the Lord. And when we come back, we're going to turn to Mark chapter 9. I want to share a word with you after we go into a season of prayer. Right now, I'm going to pray. After we pray, we will worship. Then we'll come back and go right into the word of God. Let us pray. Father, I thank you today for your presence with us. Thank you for this opportunity we have to share the word of God with my brothers and sisters. Holy Spirit, we welcome you to be where we are, be where everyone is. Begin to take the word and minister to the spirit of man. Lord, we believe and you've told us, and we believe what you say. You said that the spirit of man is a lamp of the Lord. Father, light the lamp right now. Stir up the lamp right now. Turn on the light in the inside of man. Cause us to be a light to the world. Let your light shine in our hearts, in our spirit. Dispel every darkness. Tear down every deception. Remove everything that exalts itself against you. Let the brilliance of your glory and of your majesty be revealed. Oh Lord, we call upon you today. We need light. We need light. We pray for those who once had the light shining within them, who have walked away from you, who feel condemned, or who have backslidden, who have turned away from you, or who have gotten cold. Lord, light the light again. Let there be the oil of your Holy Spirit pouring within them. Cause them to come alive. Let the revelation of Jesus transform them and awaken them to newness again. In the name of Jesus, we call every backslider back to their place of relationship to you. Oh Lord, awaken the spirit of man. Awaken the spirit of that man, of that woman, of that boy, of that girl. We pray for revival in our nation, that we will be childlike again. We will be children in our own eyes, are children before you, God, that you, our Father, may show us your mercy. You may show us your love. You are a good, good Father. That's a great God. That's who you are. You're a good, good Father. We submit to you today. God, we pray for Jamaica. Have mercy upon Jamaica. Oh, Father, we humble ourselves like children before the hand of a good, good Father. We say, Father, transform our nation. God, give us courage again. God, give us hope again. Restore courage, oh God, that our men and women may stand up for righteousness. Restore courage, oh God, that our leaders will submit themselves to you as the leader of their own hearts, and they will have courage to protect the people, to lead in righteousness. Oh God, that they will have courage to stand up against evil and corruption wherever they see it. Oh Lord, give courage to our teachers. Give courage to our preachers and our pastors. Lord, move upon us by your spirit. Stir our hearts again. Stir peace in our city. Stir peace in the street, in the heart of men and women. Make us our brother's keeper once again. Make us our sister's keeper once again. Make us loving and caring for each other once again. We look to you. You are worthy, oh God. God, we thank you that in spite of what's going on in the world, you are still changing people. You are still transforming life. You are still the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We worship you, Jehovah God. We magnify you, Jehovah God. I pray for those that are listening today, those that may be sick or have ailment and are struggling with different problems. Father, you are our Father. show forth your glory. As they lift up their voice to you, I pray you'll come near them. I pray your Holy Spirit will move upon their bodies to drive out sicknesses out of their bodies. Where things that are out of order, you'll bring it in order. Lord, those who are crying out to you with different requests, financial requests, family problems, jobs they are seeking, hear the cry of your people. Have mercy, Abba Father. We receive your hand outstretched by the power of Holy Spirit, by the working of Jesus Christ on the cross, by the mighty hand of God. We receive grace for our brothers and our sisters, healing, deliverance, wisdom, clarity, and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Praise God. Let's go into a time of worship, and then we'll come back and we'll go right into the word of the Lord today.
What does the cross of Jesus mean? It's more than songs we sing, much more than the emblem of your chain. But it means that I'm free, yes, from the chain of slavery. So the blood is shed, won't let my sins remain. Oh my. Upon the cross, my Savior died. The Lamb was crucified. Showed us love that this world had never known. Oh, what love, divine, so divine. True love you'll never find. So that we might live, love came and died alone. Well, the cross would always represent the love God had for me. Well, the Lord of glory heaven sent, gave all on Calvary just for me. Just for me. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, oh, Jesus came. For me, help me sing.
Well, the cross would always represent the love God had for me. When the Lord of glory ever sent, gave all on Calvary just for me.
Amen. Amen. Welcome back. Welcome back to the time of reflection. Looking forward to a time together. What a time to worship the Lord and to lift up his holy name. It's not too late to serve Jesus. It is not too late to give him praise. It is not too late to bow down our knees and to declare the Lordship and the power and the glory of God in the earth today. We believe that Jesus is still in control. Amen. 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 I want to talk to you in the next few minutes we have together about being a child, being a child in God's presence. You know, one of the things that is so, that you see so often is nobody wants to be called a child, and people get offended if you don't show them certain respect, and people kill each other, and people malice each other, and people backbite each other, and relationships fall apart over the word R-E-S-P-E-C-T. I need respect. But you know, there's a word that Jesus has concerning this drive for respect and this demand for people to respect us and people to treat us right. And we get mad and upset. We stop serving God. We go away from the church. We give up all these things. I want you to turn your Bible with me to Mark chapter 9 and verse 33. The Bible says that Jesus came to Capernaum. And when he was in the house, he asked them, what was it you disputed among yourselves on the road? Now, I want to go verse by verse a little bit here. So I want you to stay with me as we share in this word here today. Now, I want you to know that earlier in chapter 9, Jesus was going forth. There was a great multitude with him. He actually ministered to a young man, and God delivered him. And in fact, I know there have been some issues about devotions in schools and so forth, and what happened to some of those young people in Oberlin and all of that. It's very interesting. If you read chapter 9 of Mark, you'll see that there was a young boy who had demonic oppression, who Jesus delivered. And it's very interesting to see how the response of that deliverance. So if you're concerned about how the Holy Spirit deal with people, I think the first person you need to take it up with is what Jesus did in Mark chapter 5, because certainly there was some evidence. But, you know, the deal with Jesus, friends, and what we must always do when we're looking at these issues is, are we operating from a place of compassion? What about the children and the young people who are oppressed by the enemy? What about them being set free? How will we deliver them and set them free from the oppression of the enemy? Because we see here that the father of the child in chapter 9 was very, very, very concerned about it. What about the parents? Are you concerned about freedom coming to your children? My friends, sometimes we worried about what's on the package and how it looks and all of those things. But I'm so glad that this father just wanted his children to be free. In fact, the father said this in verse 24. The father said, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. The father was compassionate. The father wanted his son to be free. That was what motivated him. And the Bible says Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit. He said, you dumb and deaf spirit, come out of him. And look at what happened to the young man. This is a child. Look what happened. It says in verse 26, the spirit convulsed him and greatly and came out of him, and he became as dead. So many said he is dead, but Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he arose. And when he came into the house, the disciple says, why couldn't we cast it out? Jesus says, this can go that out, but by prayer and fasting. So the deliverance of children and young people from the oppression of the enemy is not new. And the unusual occurrences and unusual reactions when this freedom and deliverance is done is not new. Now, I don't know all the stories of what goes on in various places, but I just want you to know that it is not new. It is not wrong. It is not immoral. It is not unbiblical. It's right here in the Bible that some children have some very, very strong reaction because they needed strong treatment. So I pray that the Holy Spirit will give you wisdom with that. I don't know how you would interpret that, but I just want to tell you in your own life, and in your own family, and in our children, let's have compassion on them and believe God to set them free. However the Lord will do it, let him set them free. Too many of our children are in bondage. Too many of them are oppressed. Too many of them are under the bondage of immorality, pornography, drug addiction, suicidal, a spirit of abandonment, a rejection. So many things are hurting the people. Yeah, you know, it's like you're saying somebody's locked up in a prison and illegally, and someone went in and rescued them out of the prison. But while they are coming out, they get dirty and messed up, and you complain about the person who pulled them out of the prison. What about the prisoners? What about the fact that they were in bondage? Were they in bondage? Were they in prison? Those are the things I believe the conversations need to be around. Was their freedom served? Was their deliverance actually happening? Or was this just some emotional thing? That's the real issue, my friend. The real issue is not what it looks like. The real issue is what happened to those students? What happened to this young man? Was he set free? Was the spirit, the dumb and deaf spirit, cast out of them? What was the result? Was the life changed? Where there was warring, is there now peace? Where there was anxiety, is there now rest? Where there was bondage, is there now freedom? Where there was malice and confusion and even suicidal thought, is there now a relationship with God? That needs to be the investigation. That needs to be what needs to look at. And that needs to be what we understand. And so this was going on in the background, and Jesus was walking with his disciples. They came into Capernaum, the headquarters, by now. So Jesus said to them, what are you guys talking about? What were you disputing among yourselves? And my friend, I want to tell you that Jesus is very smart. You may think God doesn't know what's going on in your home or in your mind or on WhatsApp or on Facebook or on your telephone call. You may think that Jesus is not a part of your conversation, my friends, but I'm here to tell you that Jesus, though he's seated at the right hand of God the Father, he knows what you're saying. He knows what you're thinking. He knows the dispute and the confusion. He knows the words and the dialogue and the disputes and the discussions and you giving your opinion. He knows what you write on Facebook, even if you do it anonymously. He knows your voice, my friend. And so the disciples, they were disputing among themselves. I believe Jesus knew who said what. I believe Jesus knew every one of them, their different positions on this topic. I don't know what issues you're discussing today, but I want you to know that Jesus knows your opinion. And if you were smart, and if I was smart, what I would do, and I encourage you to do, is find out Jesus's position and stick with it. Learn from the master. Learn about casting out demons from the master. Learn about rescuing children back from the master. Learn about how to deal with one another by looking at Jesus. Jesus said, what are you disputing about? What are you arguing about? What are you all talking about? What's all this discussion? What's this back and forth on Facebook? What's this back and forth on WhatsApp? What are you talking about? Jesus said, I've got something to say about it. How come he didn't come to me and ask me what my opinion was? And there was a time the disciples came to Jesus and said, Lord, teach us how to pray. How come he didn't come to me, Jesus says, and bring me into your discussion? Because many times, my friend, we have ulterior motives. Gotta check our hearts, friends. So look at what they were disputing about. They kept silent, first of all. You know, when you get caught and your hand is caught in the sugar jar or in the Shirley biscuit, your hand is caught in the cookie jar, they say, nobody wants to say anything. There's quietness in the room. They kept quiet because what they talked about, the Bible says, was, who would be the greatest? Who would be the... That was the argument. Peter talking up. Yeah, man, I'm going to be the greatest. Thomas, I doubt so. You know, John, well, you know, Jesus is a loving man. I'm a loving man. I'm going to be the greatest. And they're going back and forth. So many miracles I saw. Well, you didn't cast out the demon, but I did. And on and on. Judas says, well, I have the money, so I'm going to be the greatest. You know, Matthew, I'm the tax collector. I'm the one that's the accountant. You guys, I will be the great. I mean, they're going back and forth and disputing. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, you know, they're about to fight with everybody else because they are the sons of thunder. They're going to make a statement. They think they should be the greatest. Jesus took them and he said to them, if anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all. It's interesting. Jesus didn't say we should not desire to be great or desire to be first. He didn't come out and say, hey, you know, you should not desire any kind of growth or have any ambition in what you're doing. But he tells you, if you want to be first, here's what first looks like in the kingdom of God. You see, first in the kingdom of God is not like first in the world. If you want to be first in the kingdom of God, Jesus is saying, you've got to be the servant of all. So the one who serves is first. It is an attitude. It is the attitude of a servant leader. So people are disputing. They're trying to think about their reputation, thinking about how to get promoted and all of that. Jesus says, if you want to do that, if you want to grow, if you want to be to make an impact for God, if you want to be a servant, a leader in the house of God, if you want to be great in your generation, do you want to leave a legacy? Do you want to make a difference in your generation? Do you want God to, your name to continue? Do you want people to tell stories about you? If you want to do any of that, you want to be great. The Bible says the way to do it, it's good. It's okay. It's good to want to make an impact. It's good to want to make a difference. It's okay to want to have a legacy. But how do you do it? It's not like how people said, I'm going to maneuver to become the manager of my company. I'm going to tear it on my boss. So I kick him out of the way so I can become the boss. I'm going to undermine the pastor and ridicule the pastor and set him up so that I could be the next pastor. I'm not going to support that choir leader because I don't want her. I want to be the next choir leader. I want to be the next. So we undercut each other. That's not how it works in the kingdom. Remember now, God knows what you are maneuvering. God knows what people are scheming about in order to promote themselves. Jesus says, your heart has got to be one interested on serving all. Now, I want to talk about that a little bit. Servant of all. We have an attitude in our country, in our region, where we look at certain people because of color, or because of money, or because of family name, or because of reputation, or if they have some civic position or recognition by certain people, that if he recognizes them, then I'm going to recognize them. But you know, there is something about the kingdom of God that a person is given respect simply because they're a person. They're given respect simply because they're a child of God. They're a human being. They are created in the image of God. And Jesus exemplified what he's talking about. He says, if you want to be great, you've got to be willing to serve all. You've got to be willing to serve those who will not and are not in a position to even pay you or even give you a pushback or even pay you back. When I'm going to do something for you, if you will do something for me, I'm going to help you if one day you help me. I'm going to give you a favor so that if I need it, you can give me. You know, I remember once I went up to Kingston Public Hospital to visit my brother was there in the hospital. I went in, and this guy at the gate, this security guard, he was so kind. I mean, it was about to rain. He gave me an umbrella. He was willing to lend us his umbrella so we could give it to him when we came. We're leaving. He opened up the gate. He said, oh, this is after hours, you know, but it's okay. Go ahead. You can go in. I said, man, what a nice security guard. This man is so accommodating. He knew a family member was there, and he made opportunity for me to go in. But lo and behold, brothers and sisters, on my way out, as I handed him back the umbrella, his first word to me was, leave something for me, no boss. What happened, boss? What go on? That's when I realized that he was only nice to me because he wanted something from me. That is not serving all. Serving all means you serve the lowest man as if you're serving the CEO of the company. You honor and serve a customer. You may not know who she is, as if you're serving the prime minister walking through the door. That's the principle of the kingdom of God. That's what Christian and Christian values and Judeo-Christian values is all about, my friend. It is having a commitment from our heart to serve everyone. Serve everyone. Honor everyone. Respect everyone. Treat them as your equal before God. Your child, your son, your daughter, your mother, your father, your sister. You know, can you imagine if every husband would treat their wife as if she was a sister, as God's daughter. Can you believe, can you imagine in our nation if every man would treat every woman as his sister, honorable, honorable, with respect, with watching what is said, watching what is thought, looking at what we do. Respect comes, you know, I hear people say, well, you know, respect must be earned. But I'd like to know where in the scripture that is, because the Bible doesn't say, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son because the world was so good. In fact, the Bible tells us the very opposite. God loved the world even while we were yet sinners. The principle of the kingdom of God is to serve people just because they are people. Just because they are people. Just because you love God, you love people. They don't have to earn it. They don't have to do anything for you to give it to them again. They can even abuse your respect. But you're not respecting them because they treated your respect properly. You're respecting them because you want to follow the principle of greatness in the kingdom of God. You be great by serving the least. You be great by serving those who accept your love and those who disregard your love. You be great by serving even when you serve, they take it and throw it back in your face because you are being great before God. And so Jesus wanted to show this principle of greatness. He brought a child unto him, it says in verse 36. He took a little child and set him in the midst of them. And when he had taken him in his arms, oh, I love that. Jesus took the little child and he took him in his arms. Can I tell you that when you humble yourself like a child, when you come with a childlike heart, you will be able to be taken into the arms of God. The precious, the Bible says, even the death of the saints, it is precious in the sight of God. The Bible says that we as his children are the very apples of his eyes. God loves you when you come with a servant heart. God loves you even if you don't come with a servant's heart. But you will not experience the depth and the beauty and the wonder of God's love unless you come with the humility of a child. That's why Jesus brought a child to the disciples. He didn't bring Peter. He didn't bring Andrew. He didn't bring, you know, James. He didn't bring his mother. He didn't bring any. He brought a child. And what is it about a child that is so interesting? Jesus brought a child because a child is innocently trusting his or her father. Unless there is some trauma, unless there is some drama, unless there is some scarring, unless there is some lying, unless there is some attack of the devil on a child's life, typically children are just willing to obey, willing to trust. They feel secure in the love of their parents, their mothers and fathers, in their home. They feel protected. And so they're willing to come. They're willing to go. They're willing to love. They're willing to share their toys. They're willing to obey. They're willing to do whatever the parents want done. Why? Because they trust the motive of the parent. They trust the motive of mother and father. That's why in Ephesians, the Bible says, you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath. What does that mean? It means if you lie to your children, if you create chaos in the life of your children, if there is no order and no discipline, no right and wrong in your house, and children do whatever they want, instead of those children feeling secure, they will feel insecure. They will have anxiety. When parents are walk over, you know, they are doormat. Kids will say what they want, do what they want. And then people say to the children, okay, now you have to go fend for yourself. That's not the role of a real child father. When Jesus took this child into the midst of the other disciples, he was saying to them, you see this child? This child gets his or her identity, his or her sense of worth, his or her sense of security from the parent, from the family, from the father, not from the brothers and sisters, not from uncle and auntie and cousin, not from the government. I see where some leaders of government say that the government have responsibility and care for the children. No, my friends, parents have responsibility and care for their children. And the government supports the parents in responsibility and care for the children. Teachers don't have responsibility and care for the children. Parents, you have responsibility and care for the children. And you support, the teachers come alongside to support the desire of the parents to care and prepare their children for adulthood. It's not the government separate from the parent. It's not teachers separate from parents. It is parents first, supported by teachers, supported by government agencies. Yes, my friend, Jesus put a child in the middle. And Jesus said, if you, whoever receives these little ones in my name receives me. And whoever receives me receives, whoever receives not me, but he receives him who sent me. In other words, Jesus was showing the ripple effect of having a childlike heart. Whoever receives one of these little ones, what are these little ones? These little ones are Christians, men and women who have decided to serve others. That's right. Remember, he's talking about who's greatest in the kingdom of God. And it says the one who is greatest in the kingdom of God is the one who is the servant, who is the servant of all. And the one who is a servant of all, Jesus said, is as a child. And the one who is as a child is loving on others innocently, loving, serving, helping, being a part of God's work because they trust the Father. They're doing it not to get favor or to get brownie points or get promotion or to be looked upon or to curry favor or to punch in some number that you'll put out later on. No, they're not doing it for money. They're not doing it for promotion. They're not doing it for reputation. They're not doing it for to get to collect digits or whatever it is. No, they are doing it because their father asked them to, because they love their father, because they're obedient children, and they are serving. It's like somebody coming to your house and you are asking your son or your daughter, go take their slippers, put it at the door, go get them a glass of water, go take the empty glass back into the kitchen, go get them some napkin. And the child is willingly doing these things. When we serve others, we are serving God. And God says, when we serve, we are great in his eyes. We are greatly important, greatly used, and he values us as we are doing that because we are being obedient children. And then the Lord said, if people don't receive you when you serve them, they are not receiving Jesus. And if people block you from serving them, block Jesus from serving them, they are blocking God's plan from being revealed in their life. So service is important. When you're serving people, you are allowing them to experience Jesus. When you serve the people, the least, to whatever would be called in terms of position, on positions of honor, yes, we treat those who, we treat everyone honorable, and we treat those, the Bible says, who are in places of responsibility with extra honor. So it's not like you treat nobody with honor and you only honor those in positions of responsibility and honor as leaders. But we treat them with extra honor. But everybody should be honored. Everybody should be treated and served, right? So Jesus is calling us. He said, when you serve someone, it's like Jesus serving them. That person is actually receiving the ministry of Jesus. And when that person receives your service, they receive service from Jesus. And when they receive service from Jesus, they're receiving service from God. So that's why serving people is so great. Somebody rightly says that God has no hands but our hands. He has no feet but the feet of the believer. Jesus has no mouth to speak, but he speaks the word through the mouth of you and I as Christians. He said, well, God don't need my mouth to speak. Well, he said that in Romans chapter 10. How can they hear without a preacher, somebody talking? That's what he said, to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Somebody's got to preach. How can they go? Romans 10 again, unless they are sent. Romans 10:10 tells us faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God, hearing with your ears. There's something important about speaking the word. Remember, the very creation, God said, let there be light, and there was light. God said something. He didn't just think it, he spoke it. I believe likewise today. If you want to see our families change, if you want to see our communities change, if you want to see the culture change, if you want to see Jamaica reignited for greatness, you've got to speak the word of God. You've got to talk to people. You've got to communicate the gospel to people. You've got to serve one another. We got to say thank you. We've got to say please. We've got to say you're welcome. We've got to say I'm sorry. We've got to be willing to say I forgive you. We've got to say things to each other. We've got to serve one another. Give someone a cup of water. Give them an extra meal, shine their shoes, open the door for them. Don't just open the door for people you like. Just open the door because you're there. Don't just pick up the paper for in the houses you like. Pick up the paper because it's the right thing to do. Serve one another. Oh, my brothers and sisters, you know, our history of slavery and people in sociologists, and they would say, well, our psyche has been damaged in terms of serving, and we think it's slavery whenever we do something for someone without earning it. Well, my friends, I believe it's the flesh. It's the flesh. It's selfishness. It's pride. It's we want to be first. We see here in the dispute among the disciples, it wasn't anything about slavery. It was simply that, you know what? They wanted to be first. My friends, we can go back all we want. The issue is, yes, there were issues in history, but you weren't a slave back then. There was no DNA thing that came down from your great, 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 great grandparents that says you ought to now be the greatest of all. No, that is, it's called the flesh. It's called pride. It's an issue that all mankind face with, something you cannot excuse away because of our heritage or because of the history or the pain of our foreparents. The blood of Jesus was shed so that you and I can forgive. The blood of Jesus was shed so that you and I, my friend, can serve one another. We can humble ourselves. The place of service is what we need in Jamaica today. We need to serve one another. You know, I think it's so sad that we are willing to serve the tourists from Germany or Russia or America or England or even Bermuda or the tourists come from Spain. We are so nice. We are so gentle. We are so hospitable. Let us recapture the spirit of hospitality for our own brothers and sisters. Let us recapture the spirit of servitude for the man in the taxi, the woman down the street, for each other, our brothers and our sisters whom we live with. The Lord tells us that. You've got to serve the least. You know, your brothers and sisters may not be able to give you any tip. They may not be willing or be able to give you money for serving them, but God will. See, when you serve them, you are bringing Jesus to them. When you serve them, you're bringing God to them. I believe there's a lot of things that God wants to do in our nation, but he cannot find enough servants. Ezekiel said, the Lord is looking for a man or a woman to stand in the gap. What can he say? When he comes, will he find faith in the earth? Will we find faith in your heart, willing to be a servant? Humble yourself. Don't be a worry about the reception of your service. Let me say it again. Don't worry about the reception of your service. Who are we serving? You are serving Jesus. You are serving God, because it is what the Bible says, Whoever receives one of these little ones, those who serve in my name, receives me. Whoever receives me receives him, not me, but him who sent me. So it's all the way back to God. So likewise, that's what I'm saying to you. Don't worry about the reaction or the response of those you serve, because they are responding not to you, but to Jesus and to God. And obviously, as we can see here from verse 37, Jesus and God can take care of themselves. Jesus and God will back you up. Jesus and God will settle. Don't become bitter. Don't start to say, oh, them people, them. Don't say things like, them not worth it. Don't say, they're not worth it. Don't say, I'm tired. Don't say, no, enough. No. How many times has God shown love to you? How many times have others served you? How many times has Jesus served you? See, the model here is Jesus, not other people. Has Jesus ever served you and taken anything from you? Has Jesus ever served you and robbed you off or disappointed you? Has Jesus ever served you and left you hanging? Jesus has always served you. He served you in the morning. He'll serve you in the evening. Every time you call upon him, he's there to serve you, to love you. I'm here to tell you today that that is what Jesus wants you and I to be, a child. He wants us to be a child. And you know, even in the next verse, you see the same attitude of lack of service. They came to Jesus and said, we saw someone else who does not follow you, casting out demons in your name. And we forbade him because he does not follow us. You know, someone casting out demons. We don't like the way they did it, or they're not doing it in your name. And what's going on here? Jesus says, do not forbid him, for no one who works a miracle in my name can soon afterwards speak evil of me. For he who is not against us is on our side. For whoever gives you a cup of water to drink in my name, because you belong to Christ, assuredly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward. Verse 42, but whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to stumble, it will be better for him if a millstone were put around his neck and he were cast into the sea. My friends, serve. Just serve people. Just serve people. God will back you up. Jesus says if people will try to hurt you when you serve many times. They say, oh, you're acting better than us. You're acting prideful and all kind of things. But the Lord says, I'll deal with the offense. I will deal with them when they hate you and despisefully say things against you just because you're serving. He says, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed rather than to have two hands go to hell and to go to hell into the fire that shall never burn, where the worm does not die and where the fire is not quenched. The Lord is saying, you just serve. Do whatever you can. If you have to separate yourself from some things, if you've got to rearrange your priority, if you have to cut off some things so you can serve, serve. Find a way to serve. Those of you have been stuck at home due to COVID for all these years, get back to service. Get back to serving the house of God. And by the way, everybody does not need to go back to serve inside the church. How about finding ways to serve Jesus in your community? Serve the poor. Serve the widows. Serve those young men on the corner. Serve those young women at that dance hall. Serve that young man on ganja addiction. Serve people. Serve the homeless. Serve the leaders, the politicians. They need people to serve them with love and with the fear of God. Serve. And you will see the miracle of God protecting you. The Lord says in verse 45, if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life rather than have 2 feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that shall never quench. For where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye rather than having 2 eyes to be cast into hell, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. You've got 2 hands. You've got a mouth. You've got eyes. You've got feet. You've got a body. Use it to serve the Lord. Use your body. Use your hand. Use your time. Use your resources. Use your wealth. Serve. Find ways to serve the Lord. And if something is going to stop you, you need to cut it off. You need to prioritize it. That's what it's trying to say here. That's what it is saying. Be like that trusting child, willing to do what the Father has asked you to do to touch other people. I'll finish up with these next few verses. Verse 49. For everyone will be seasoned with fire, and every sacrifice will be seasoned with salt. Salt is good, but if the salt loses its savor or its flavor, how will you season it? Have salt in yourself and have peace with one another. What a wonderful word today. Have salt in yourself. Be the kind of person that salts the world, brings seasons to the world. You make a difference by serving people. Serving people. If the salt has lost its savor, you know, how will it be seasoned? It's good for nothing. You've got to stir yourself up. You've got to make a commitment today to be a servant of Jesus, to be a servant of people. That if you take the word child, C-H-I-L-D, quickly, I want to just give you a couple words to connect to that. The word C stands for converted. This is a work of the Holy Spirit. Unless you're converted, you'll not be able to be a child and serve people. You will always do it with a manipulation and looking for others. So you've got to be converted and trust the Holy Spirit to do this in your heart. You ask the Lord, say, Lord, I want to be a child. Lord, I humble myself. You pray and ask the Lord to give you a childlike heart. That's what David says. Lord, renew a right spirit within me. So if you want to serve like this, you want to be great in God's kingdom, begin to ask God to give you a childlike heart, innocent, obedient to him. Say, Lord, convert my heart. Change me in my heart. Make me like that child to serve others. Next, you got to be holy. H stands for holy. The Bible says you got to come out from among them. Be not conformed to the world in Romans chapter 12. But there must be a transformation of sanctification, setting aside yourself. Here again, it is a prayer and a commitment. So Holy Spirit, make me holy. I commit to walk in holiness before the Lord. Children are, their hearts are converted into innocence, and they have a righteous walk. They have an innocent walk to be a child. I stands for intimacy with Jesus. You know, it's not your grandmother relationship. It's not your grandfather relationship. It's not your father or your pastor's relationship. You have to have an intimate relationship with the Father. Every child is a child of that Father, not a grandfather. God is not your grandfather. God is your Father. God wants you to serve others on his behalf. Amen? So you have intimacy. So C is for convert. H is for holy. I is for intimacy with God, intimate relationship. L is for love. You know, when you read the Bible tells us to love God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, with all our strength, and we need to love our neighbor as ourselves. If we are children before God, we're going to love people. We're going to serve people. We're going to do it not to gain favor, not to gain popularity, not for things on our Facebook page. We won't go out and tell people what we do for others. We just serve people because we love God. We just serve people because we love people, because they are made in the image of God. And D stands for discipleship. You know, when you discipline a child, when you set rules and you correct them, it's not for the benefit of the parents. You don't do it out of joy. But correction and discipline and discipleship, things like learning to pray, learning to read the Bible, having a regular prayer and Bible reading time, going to church, those are all spiritual disciplines. And that's called discipleship, learning the doctrines of the Bible, learning the teachings of Jesus. Those are called discipleship, becoming a disciple. Those are things that make us children. We are converted in our spirit from a pride and selfishness to selflessness. We are holy. We are committing ourselves to walk in sanctification and righteousness before God. We develop intimate relationship with God. We love people. We love God. We keep growing in that love, and we grow in discipleship. We grow as a disciple. We begin to talk more like how God wants us to talk. We begin to respond more the way God wants us to respond. Even our desires in life and our goals and aspiration begin to align with God. That is what a child is about. Father, I pray that you make us children. Change our heart. Convert us. Make us holy. Give us a place of intimacy with you. Oh, Lord, lead us that we may love people and that we may be true disciples of you. I ask you today, Lord, deliver us from pride and arrogance and for searching for prominence and to big up ourselves and all these ways of accolades and looking for reward from one another. Oh, Lord, forgive us for looking for reward for one another. Give us a heart of service. Teach me how to serve better. Teach me to serve more. Teach me to serve my brothers and sisters for the glory of your name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Well, I certainly trust that today's our time together, time of reflection, was a blessing to you. I want to encourage you to once again, you know, share this page, share with others about our teachings on the midday here on Faith Broadcasting Network, here on YouTube, here on Facebook, and join us again next time so we can be together in spreading the word of the Lord. Let's be children. Let's serve one another. If you have any questions, the numbers are on the screen. If you have a prayer request, there's a number on the screen as well. And before I close, I want to let you know about Emmanuel Caribbean University, where I serve as the president. We are getting ready for our spring semester, or starting in January. I want to encourage you to check out our website, ecujamaica.com. We have some exciting classes that will help to equip you as a servant of God, equip you for ministry in the church and ministry in the marketplace. We have some exciting technology classes that we are looking forward to roll out in January as well. But you can sign up for a certificate or a diploma or the bachelor's in ministry degree here with us at ECU. And by the way, if you have some children that are in the primary school area, primary school level, or even high school level, we have an after-school program. We have tutoring for either high school and primary. You can get in touch with us at our website as well to find out about these various ministries of Emmanuel Caribbean University. ecujamaica.com. That's our website, ecujamaica.com. God bless you. Thank you for joining me today. Let's serve one another and not worry about titles. Bye-bye.